you know, we got to this very large size in September of 2008. We reached $4.5 billion, which by Asian standards was considered to be a very large amount of money. We didn't think it was unmanageable, and indeed it hasn't proven to be problematic in returning more than half of that money. We've had a lot of redemptions in the last 12 months, all of which we've met very easily. We never constrained the capital of the fund, and we felt that was very important. But the essential characteristics of both Barracuda and AB2 were a combination of arbitrage and long volatility, AB2 being significantly longer volatility. And that has given the funds a very unusual characteristic for Asian hedge funds, which is that it negatively correlates with markets. There's a strong correlation between Asian hedge funds and Asian markets. Principally, people in Asia come to look for growth and to look for the exciting growth opportunity that is Asia. And there are still, although traditionally there have been, great ways of playing that, either through distressed debt, through buying physical assets, or through buying stocks. And generally speaking, these funds have done pretty well, but it's come with a very high level of volatility, and it's come with a very high level of correlation with markets. To a certain extent, we offset that because we have our best months when the markets have their worst months, because that's when volatility spikes the most. And that's been why we've been able to raise a significant amount of money and become one of the larger homegrown hedge funds in Asia, as you say, even though our strategy is considered by some to be a niche or boutique strategy.
You also have two more funds, right? One is a Russia fund, and the other one you had a convertible fund for some time.
Yeah, we started the Russian fund about almost exactly 3 years ago. My brother, Martin, had been in Moscow since 1994. He'd been a partner at Brunswick, which had been a very successful Swedish partnership bought by UBS. Subsequent to that, he retired, but was in the process of launching his own hedge fund. And we decided it would be a good idea to partner with him. He knows Russia extremely well, but we feel we understand the risk side well. And the fund incorporates his stock picking skills with a significant put protection overlay, which we manage from here. And over the 3 years, we've been, I think, very successful. The fund right now is up about 40% from inception. And despite the fact it's always had a very significant long bias, the Russian market's down 25% over the period. So the put protections really worked, particularly last year when the Russian market got crushed. It was down about 75%. Our fund was down a fair bit as well, but nothing like as much. So that protected the capital. We launched, in some ways, our best timed fund, which was a long-only convertible bond fund in the teeth of the crisis last year. We launched in October 2008 and the fund's launch date was the 1st of November 2008. Very surprised that anyone was launching a convertible bond fund at this time, because it was a period of extraordinary dislocation for the convertible bond industry and the hedge fund component of this especially. But we felt there was compelling value in Asia. Convertible bonds around the world have been crushed, but we felt that the underlying strength of Asia was there was a lot less leverage on balance sheets than in the West. And generally speaking, we felt that the Asian markets would hold up better than Western markets, because generally the level of indebtedness and the level of leverage and the level of excess in Asia had been significantly less. So we started buying convertibles in November 2008, unleveraged and without a prime broker, because at the time it was very unclear how you'd get funding. Because at the time, and perhaps one of the major constituents of the crisis, was that prime brokers were pulling lines from convertible bond arbitrage and forcing them to dump bonds on a market that was already distressed. And over the next 11 months, the market rallied extraordinarily strongly, and we made a 29% return. By October, we really felt the prices were, once again, had gone from being extremely distressed to now very fully valued. So we actually returned the money to our investors and closed the fund down last month, having, say, made 29% unleveraged, which we were very happy with. Obviously, it was a great return. Because we're always long volatility, we're often seen as being perpetually bearish. So it was great to launch a fund that was extreme, in fact, was long only absolute return and significantly bullish, and to have a success with that. So that fund is no longer actively managed. We're awaiting to see if there will be another opportunity to buy these. That remains to be seen, but the fund's currently dormant right now. So we're very much focused on Barracuda AB2. That's our core focus. Russia's run principally from our Geneva and Moscow offices, though I do keep a close eye on the risk and actually manage the hedge component here.
Can you explain us more how Asia and Singapore have evolved as hedge fund centers over the last, let's say, 5 years?
We chose to come to Singapore in 2001 because we were attracted by a combination of things, all of which have really remained, I think, significant selling points for Singapore as a hedge fund center. Firstly, there's a cost component here, which is that when we first started, we were very cost conscious. We had virtually no assets under management, so we had to be. Costs in Singapore are significantly lower than they are in Hong Kong and significantly lower than they are in Tokyo. That's whether that's office space or the cost of hiring skilled staff. They are materially lower. More importantly, the regulatory environment in Singapore continues to be extremely positive about hedge funds at a time when a lot of other jurisdictions are looking negatively at the hedge fund industry. Singapore has continued to be extremely positive about hedge funds, and the Monetary Authority of Singapore, which regulates the financial industry here, have continued to very transparent and consistent approach towards the industry. We have, through the whole period, existed under an exempt status, which is that as long as the money is only raised from a small number of external professional investors, that we're non-regulated. That has worked during the growth of the industry, but I think there's a general consensus now in Singapore that the usefulness of that regime has probably outlived its period of usefulness. And we generally anticipate that in 2010, the industry will, and the MAS will move to regulating Singapore. But we don't expect a particularly heavy or burdensome level of regulation. I think the Monetary Authority of Singapore have continued to have an attitude which is consistent with Singapore, which is that this is a laissez-faire capitalist society, very heavily regulated by the law, which is something I'll come back to in a second, but essentially one where professional investors are free to make their own decisions without a heavy burden of regulation. And caveat emptor is a principle which exists within virtually all business that is done in Singapore. We also have a very light tax regime here. The top rate of both corporate and personal tax is quite low, and the treatment of external capital and capital gains and dividends is also very attractive. So you combine a strong legal system, and there is the one thing one must say about Singapore: it has a very strong, even draconian legal code, low tax, and laissez-faire capitalism, with a regulator that seems to understand what we do and understand our needs, but also free but fair system of governance, has made an extremely good place to establish hedge funds. And Hong Kong, to a very large degree, has matched those. It's been perhaps a little less even in Hong Kong. There have been some things about Hong Kong that we have questioned. For a long time, there was a notorious examination that used to have to be taken by hedge fund managers. It took a long time to get established in Hong Kong, as much as 6 months sometimes. So that was a deterrent to establishing there. We also have never really particularly liked the fact that there is significant short selling restrictions in Hong Kong. So Hong Kong's to a certain extent had two faces to the world of hedge funds. On the one hand, it's been welcoming to hedge funds, and certainly there's a lot of very successful hedge funds there. But on the other hand, it's very difficult to actually operate as a hedge fund, particularly if you're long short, in Hong Kong, because the restrictions around short selling are quite significant. That doesn't exist in Singapore. So we've been very happy here, but that's not to say that it's the only place to be.